Bohra, distinguished members in the audience and young friends. The title of your conference is rather forbidding. I've been trying to figure it out for the last week or two, and I still haven't succeeded in understanding what it exactly means. However, therefore, I thought what I would do is to just mention a few general dimensions of management, which may not be taught in management schools, but which are very important for the development of the nation. Because we are today facing a very difficult situation politically, economically, and socially, and therefore management techniques need to be introduced at all levels if we are to maximize our strengths and minimize our weaknesses. First of all, let's talk about managing the political system. Very often you find that parliament is becoming dysfunctional. The sessions are disrupted, the number of days the parliament sits are very few, and the whole parliamentary system seems to be under great pressure. Before that, the electoral system needs to be managed. And in elections, as you know, that is where really the trouble starts. Because our elections have become so expensive now. Even to get a ticket, I believe, you've got to pay a crore of rupees, far less to fight an election. Where is that money going to come from? And if that money comes from so-called black money, then it will multiply. So unless at the source of the whole electoral process, we are able to have a different management program, we will never get out of this double bind. I have certain ideas regarding electoral reform. It's a very long subject, I won't get into it. One of them, for example, is there should be compulsory voting. I see no reason why those people who enjoy the benefits of democracy should not have to vote once a year or once in 5 years. You can't have the benefits and not make your contribution. There's no big deal. Australia has voting, which is universal. And therefore, voting becoming compulsory, I would say, is a very important factor. Because then you would get a better idea of what the people really want. At present, there's 50% voting, out of which there may be 10 candidates. Very often somebody with 15 or 20% of the vote gets elected, who does not really reflect the majority opinion even in his constituency. Now there's a very easy way to do it. Pass a law, if somebody is ill, they can be taken there, one day paid leave to labour so that they don't lose any salary. And compulsory voting, I think, would make a big difference. Then this business of this group voting or that caste voting will be cut down, everybody will then have to vote. Secondly, I feel, and here I do not know whether everybody will agree with me, after the first round of voting, the people who have the top two votes should have a stand runoff. And it's quite easy now with your voting machines. So then you will get a really accurate picture of what the people want. Also, funding of elections. There has to be state funding of elections. We have to limit the number of people who can stand. There are 150 or 250 political parties today in India. Nobody's heard of many of them. Many are sort of fly-by-night parties. They're set up in order to be able to put some black money into that account. So, there has to be substantial electoral reform and proper management of the whole. The electoral system is managed very well. I must say an Indian general election is one of the finest management examples in the world, along with the Indian census. I don't think anything that can beat that. But the micromanagement of the electoral system, I do think, needs to be addressed, and that will bring younger and more committed political people into the electoral system. I find it very unfortunate that people are tarring all politicians with the same brush. Now that is not acceptable. There are people who have been in politics for years and years who have tried to serve the country. There are some black sheep. There are problems in that case, but that doesn't mean that you can condemn the whole political class. Because in the final analysis, in a democracy, you need elections. And for elections, you need the politicians. Therefore, it's no use saying that all politicians are crooks and what is this. This is a wrong statement. They tend to denigrate the whole structure of our democracy. So the first thing I'd like to say, as far as politics is concerned, we've got to manage it better. We've got to manage our funding of elections. There are many ways in which it can be done. And we've got to try and see that the costs of elections become reasonable. Because if the elections are so expensive, then nobody really can fight unless they have a lot of money or are backed by somebody with a lot of money. So I feel that managing politics is the first important dimension of that. The second obvious dimension is managing our economy. Now, as you know, we are in a difficult economic position today. Our rate of growth, of which we were very proud, has slowed down. We are still doing much better than many countries in the world. But nonetheless, there have been some disturbing trends of late. There has been a long trend in food production. There's been a downtrend in industrial production. And at the same time, we are fighting against the increase in population. Do you realize that every year we add one Australia to the population of India? So population is growing. And if our economy does not grow, then we are going to be in really serious trouble. And therefore, now I can't go into the question of managing the economy. That's a very macro problem, what your fiscal policy should be, what your tax policies, etc., what incentives should be given. But I would like to say this, that all these social welfare schemes that we have initiated, unprecedented, the Mahatma Gandhi Narega scheme, the urban regeneration scheme, the food scheme, now the compulsory right to food, the right to education. These are great schemes, but how are they being managed? Why is it that the money that we sanction from the center do not get to the people for whom they are meant? A lack of management. A lack of proper adjustment. Why can't we do it? Why can we not? You know, the amount of money that has been put into social welfare in the last 50 years is more than, last 5 years is more than was put in the last 50 years. And yet people say we can't get the money. So whether it is the Mahatma Gandhi Narega scheme or this new food right scheme, right to food, or the public distribution system, we cannot get our act in order because of corruption, because of the all-pervasive corruption and lack of a managerial policy. The panchayats were put forward in order to implement these policies. I don't know what they are doing. Why is it that people are still saying that out of every rupee that we sanction, hardly 20 paisa gets to the person? I mean, there's a shame and a disgrace. And it involves a massive change in our attitudes towards economic management. So I would say that on the one hand, we have to manage the polity. On the other hand, we have to manage the economy. And it's very important that in this economic growth, the people, particularly in the rural areas, should not be merely passive recipients of aid. They should be active participants in the processes of growth. That is what the whole panchayati system is all about. And that is where young people who are here will have to see that growth becomes inclusive and people become involved in the processes of growth and don't just keep asking for this and asking for that. And the people also have to fulfill their responsibilities. Everybody talks about fundamental rights. We are proud of our fundamental rights, they are justiciable. What about the fundamental duties? How many of you in the audience even know that there is a chapter on fundamental duties in the Constitution? And how many duties there are? I'm not going to embarrass you by asking you to raise your hand. But the fact of the matter is that very few people even know that there's a chapter on fundamentals. I was on the drafting commission with Sardar Swaran Singh when we drafted that those duties. Nobody's interested in duties. Ek haath se taari nahi bajti. De do, give me more salary, give me more work. Fair enough. What are you doing? Are you fulfilling your duties or not? Are you acting in a disciplined manner or not? Are you acting in a social supportive manner or not? So therefore, managing the economy really involves not only major fiscal policies, but a possibility to bring managerial techniques down to the grassroots. And I suggest that that is what management institutions should talk about, not only about five-star companies and huge takeovers and all. That's fine. I'm not in any way denigrating them. But if the pyramid is weak, then our whole economic structure is also weak. The third element of management involves managing the environment. Now, the environment, as you know, has been greatly, very greatly damaged, and it has deteriorated a great deal over the last 20, 30, 40 years. We've lost thousands of species, forests have disappeared, the glaciers are receding, and the whole aspect of global warming has become a major problem. Now here again, this is a whole area. We just had a meeting in Durban, and I was at Kyoto when the Kyoto meeting took place. I was at Stockholm in the first United Nations Conference on the Human Environment in 1972. So I've been in it from the birth. And a lot has to be done, but a lot of that also depends on managing the environment, managing our forests, managing our green areas, and managing our constructions. I mean, our slums are growing like cancers. How will the environment ever be saved if there is unplanned growth of slums and jhuppies all across the country? So are we managing our resources properly? Or are we just letting everything getting politicized and therefore not able to do what we need to do? So managing the environment, I suggest, is a very important area. We have to strike a balance between environment and development. You may notice recently there's been an unfortunate clash. Either we should clear the environmental processes well before the work starts. Once the work starts and thousands of crores of rupees are spent, then suddenly the environmental problems come up. What do you do? Do you write off all that money? Or do you somehow or the other try and compensate the people? So this requires proper planning and management. I think it is bad management that you start a function, huge project, and then suddenly the people start protesting. You have to clear that before you start a project. And this has to be done again in a managerial way. What do you do with people who suffer? What do you do with people who are displaced? Even today, the Bhakra Dam and Pong Dam, ousties as they call themselves, are still hanging around 50 years later. So we've got to rethink our economic development and our environmental development, particularly in the environment, because we're coming up with nuclear power plants, we're coming up with all sorts of other huge projects, and unless we're able to get these properly organized, they'll all collapse. If they collapse, it will be a massive waste of resources, of scarce resources. So managing the environment, I suggest, is something which also needs to be built into your managerial awareness. Fourthly, managing society. Our society is becoming dysfunctional. There is so much tension. There is so much conflict. If two boys of different religions or even of different castes have a clash, the whole village will go up in flames. We seem to be living on the edge of a volcano, and any little chingari can set fire to it. Now, why is it that we are unable to manage society? This is another very deep area. I'm just touching upon it. Empowerment of women, for example, is one of the ways we can do it. Because where women are empowered, we find that the growth is much more balanced. And that is why in the Panchayati Raj institutions, 1/3 of the posts are reserved for women. And that is why the two major parties in India are committed to 1/3 reservation of women in Parliament, although we've not been able to get the bill through. So empowerment of women. And now with the nuclear family, what has happened is the joint family has broken up. The support, psychological and physical and financial, that used to be there in the joint families are no longer there. We've come to the nuclear family. Now the nuclear family is a great advance in many ways. But the nuclear family also becomes more vulnerable. And therefore we have to work towards a harmonious relationship within the family. So this may not be management in the technical sense of the term, but if there is a family which is full of tension and full of anger, you won't get a balanced society. And the family relationship, as you know, revolves around two poles. It revolves around the man-woman relationship and the parent-child relationship. As far as the man-woman relationship is concerned, it has to be one of equals. The day has gone when the women are supposed to walk 3 paces behind us. Nor do I like the absurd Western tradition of the woman walking 3 paces in front. I think they are equally ridiculous. In fact, this reminds me of a story. There was a person who was posted in a country. Country shall remain nameless. And when he was there first, he found the women were walking 3 paces behind the men. So he went back to the United Nations. And 10 years later, he came there again. And then he noticed the women were walking 3 paces ahead. So he said to his friend, he said, you know, you've had a tremendous social revolution. I'm very impressed. He said, no, no. There has been a civil war and there are many unexploded mines lying around. So that's not how we want the woman relation. We want Ardhangini, which is the ancient Indian concept of the man and woman, as co-equal partners in the adventure of life. As far as parents and children are concerned, my opinion and my experience has been that Indian parents are too possessive. They try and run the lives of their children, which cannot be done. As Khalil Gibran says, your children come through you but do not belong to you. They come with their own karma. They come with their own genetic configuration. And therefore, while we should be supportive, we cannot try and run the lives of our children. I think Indian parents have to realize that the times have changed. Children should respect their parents, certainly, but they have their own views. And they have to be given, those views have to be given due weight. So these are some of the things in society I wanted to mention. The three C's, corruption, communalism and casteism. These three between them have shattered the fabric of our society. And we need, as was mentioned, we need a new social contract. We need a new social contract and we have to see what we can do. So I've spoken about managing the polity, managing the economy, managing the environment, managing society. And my last and final point is, and perhaps you are not taught this in your college, managing yourselves. Are you taught to manage yourself, to manage your body, for example? Is anybody taught how to sit, how to breathe? Is anybody taught that keeping your body fit is your best investment for the future? If you poison your bodies through alcohol or tobacco or unsafe sex or drugs or whatever, you are the ones who are going to suffer. So you must, first of all, the body is the temple of the Lord. The body is sharira madhyam khalu dharma sadhana. The body alone is the basis of all dharma. And therefore, first of all, we've got to manage our body. You can't live on junk foods. You can't allow yourself to become obese. You have to keep your body fit and subtle and well in order to meet the challenges. So that when you become my age, and I'm now 80, you will be able to be fit and well. Then you've got to manage the mind. Managing the mind is very difficult. Because the mind is almost almost invisible and unmanageable. And yet I think that you've got to manage the mind, you've got to be able to concentrate your mind. There is so much information coming in nowadays. There's a tsunami of information. From that information you've got to abstract knowledge. And from knowledge you've got to distill wisdom. That is the whole goal of education. So the capacity to manage your mind, to concentrate, to think about a certain problem in a creative manner, that is very important in this age. Then you've got to manage your emotions. If you're full of anger and rage and hatred and revenge and jealousy, let me tell you, these can be as lethal as TB and cancer and any other disease. Because there's a psychosomatic linkages are there now. And if you're not able to have a calm mind and calm emotions, you're going to get into trouble. So this is also, in a way, a very important managing area. And finally, managing the spirit. Getting in touch with the deeper recesses of your consciousness. What is it within us that makes us unique? The Vedanta says, Ishvara sarva bhutanam hriddeshe tishtati. The Lord resides in the heart of all beings. Whatever your spiritual path, whatever your religion, the Bible calls it the light that lighteth every man that comes into the world. The Sufis call it the Noor-e Rohani. The seers of the Upanishad say, Vedaha metam purusham mahantam aditya varnam tamasam parastar. I have seen that great being shining like a thousand suns beyond the darkness. So you have to look inwards also. Unfortunately, none of this is taught in our schools or universities. Because we can't teach religion, we throw the baby out also with the bathwater. And so many people just skim through life without once diving deep into the recesses of your own consciousness. Subh hoti hai, sham hoti hai, umar yun hi tamam hoti hai. It's an opportunity. Remember, this is a unique opportunity. Human life is not just a casual thing. It's a unique opportunity for spiritual growth. And young people have to realize this. Remember what Bernard Shaw said about youth. He said, youth is a wonderful thing. What a pity it is wasted on the young. Meaning thereby that young people don't always realize the tremendous capacities ahead. Friends, we are living in very exciting times. It is a privilege to be alive at this time when the world is changing. Every day the world is changing. New possibilities are opening. We cannot have the negativity that we find everywhere. We cannot have the gloom and doom that seems to engulf us. We've got to reassert our rights. We've got to reassert our privilege to build a new world. And that finally is our goal, is to build a new world, a new society, a new kind of consciousness on Project Earth. And I would say that I'll end with that great verse from the Katupanishad, which exhorts us to awake and arise and walk across the razor-edged path to our goal. The path is difficult, friends. There are no soft options, either for individual salvation or for collective enlightenment. You have to go across that difficult path. But it is only by crossing that difficult and dangerous path that we can reach our goal. And as I said, our goal is a new society, a new India, a new world. Uttishta, jagrata, prapya varan nivodhata, shurasya dhara nishita gunatya, durgam patasya avayoga. Thank you.